Human Resource Management, a Postmodern Reading. This session is titled as Human Resource Management, a Postmodern Reading. This session is based on an article written by Dr. Dambika Jayawardhana, Senior Lecturer attached to the Department of Business Administration, and Dr. Prajna Seniviratne, attached to the Open University. This is very interesting topic and it is to be reviewed for understand the application of HRM in the world context as well as local context. When reviewing world history, there are different eras. Here I use basically two eras. One is feudalistic society. Second one is capitalistic society. Managing labor is an inevitable outcome of the capitalist mode of production. Capitalist mode of production disconnects the root from the feudalistic society. It means that when introducing capitalist mode of production, root of feudalistic society or structure of feudalistic society was changed. The remarkable thing happened in the society was introducing social classes by the capitalist mode of production. It said goodbye to the landlord and peasants or farmers. According to Marx and Engels, industrial production in feudalist society was monopolized by the closed society. It means that feudalistic society was functioning with closed system. Therefore, there was no longer sufficient suffice for growing wants of new market. In feudalistic society, manufacturing system took its place. The guild masters were pushed aside by the manufacturing middle class. Division of labor between the different cooperative guilds vanish in the face of division of labor in each single workshop. Capitalist mode of production was able to discontent from the feudalistic mode of socio-cultural relationship, because in the feudalistic mode of production was upheld more assertive, heroic, basic and marginalizing women. Feudalistic mode of production or socio-cultural relationships still maintained by the underdeveloped post-colonial countries like Sri Lanka. Capitalistic mode of production was transplanted opposing the evolution of mode of production. Feudalistic socio-cultural relationship symbolizes inner relationship as well as overt or open part of it. In capitalist mode of production, it symbolizes not in the same manner as appeared in feudalist context, but in a quite covered manner. This is equally true as far as the space given to women in so-called modern organization are concerned. In this context, the authors attempted to reread human resource management, the symbolic process of managing labor in modern organization in underdeveloped post-colonial context with a postmodern sensibility. Aim of this article is explore and play the agenda of gender, agenda of gender in so-called personnel management, human resource management, knowledge or intellectual capital management. Genealogy of managing labor. In this section, the authors try to analyze the evolution of labor utilization with critical review. Present outlook of managing labor is an episode of its historical evolution. When reviewing the history or genealogy of managing labor, female was characterized as marginalized group, ignored group, and abandoned group. Throughout the evolution of managing labor, male labor is predominant. What is the gray area of genealogy of managing labor, especially between the transition period from feudalistic mode of production to capitalistic mode of production? Capitalistic mode of production made radical changes over feudalistic mode of production. Feudalistic mode of production put into the dustbin of history. Expropriate the farmers from their land, and craftsmen became unemployed. Then there were new bourgeoisie and its rival partner, proletarian. Bourgeoisie, Madhyama Panthika Janaya, proletarian, Nirdhana Panthiya. At the beginning of capital mode of production, female labor was hired as paid worker. Then male labor was at home as unpaid, voluntary type, unimportant kind of work. Male labor had played a role as the role done by women under feudalistic society. In 1939 in England, 56% of female workers were working at cotton factories. 69% of female workers were at woolen mills. Of female workers were doing work as workers in silk mills and flax spinning factories. According to the authors, inviting female laborers to the factories was not an open invitation, because they hired females as worker without nurturing values. The main purpose of hiring female as workers to the factory was hiring labor with the cheap labor. In other way, the reason was replacing women as cheap labor. Early stage of capitalist mode of production, female labor was replaced for male labor, but didn't much affect the gender stereotyping of the organization. It means that they had not uphold or accept feminine values in organization. They expected masculine values through female labor. However, At that period, managing mechanism of organization was rested on men's hand, not the women's hand. Then the authors argued that it merely took time for male labor to adjust to these changes. According to the article, organization remained as male domain by compelling women to just play men's role. As a result of emerging capitalistic mode of production, it was gradually putting gender dynamic of division of labor into the feudalistic society. It became a crisis. Emerging capitalistic mode of production only bring the paid women, not any supremacy over the others. It made reversal of all relations within the family. However, other social relations were unchanged. At the home, there was tending the reign of the wife over the husband. At the home, there was tending the reign of the wife over the husband because of the factory system. Employment of women in factory system in early stage of capitalistic mode of production was trap. What is the trap? Woman was to be a vagrant, no masculine symbols, even to cope with their new roles, even putting the traditional family life at the risk. In the capitalistic mode of production, female supremacy or glory cannot guard it with nurturing values. Then it concluded that capitalist mode of production in early stage replaced biological women or women who were compelled to intertwine assertive values of men's work for maximizing surplus value of factories. However, from the factory side did not set their agenda to enable women with nurturing values. Therefore, managing labor remained as unchanged, indeed a male domain. Managing labor in Ceylon 1. In this section, the authors try to review the evolution of labor in Sri Lanka. In Ceylon, managing labor was not appeared in England or any other classical form of the rest of the world. English people introduced capitalistic mode of production to the country and it created peculiar or unusual social economic system. In primitive growth, all revisions are crucial. People leave or shifted for capital class in course of formation. As Marx, expropriations of agriculture, producer, farmer is the basis of the whole process. In Ceylon, plantation sector was the first inroad of capitalist mode of production. They planted coffee. It was the viable enterprises in Ceylon at that day. However, salaries of civil servants were reduced on the recommendation of the Colebrook Commission at 1832. But at that time, they had owned land and make up their lost income through the investment in commercial agriculture. However, these changes were not adequate to expropriate the agricultural population from the soil. What was the attitude of Sinhalese at that time? They were not willing to work as a hired labor. Therefore, Sinhalese villagers were with a small farmer holders and they were somewhat independent minded. As a result, the early stage of capitalist mode of production in Ceylon did not lead men to be unemployed and women to be employed as appeared in Europe. Then they are most unable to expropriate farmers from their soil by creating a proletarian class. In 1911, Colombo had only 4.4% of total working population. Working population in the plantation sector was 40%. When reviewing world evolution of utilizing labor, early stage of mode of production in Ceylon did not invite women to just take men's role in organization. In 1908, 4,000 women and girls were employed as metal breaking and road workers. This amount is insignificant when considering the number of men employed. However, in plantation sector, role of women played the major role. The authors made an argument based on these things as introducing capitalism through plantation sector was unable to end or even disturb gender stereotyping in the organization. In other way, this movement did not affect masculine-feminine relationship in feudalistic society. It remained the factories as male domain, not only when its value are concerned, but even when number is concerned. Managing labor in Ceylon too. In this period, major incident of managing labor was that introducing industrial law. As a result of rejecting to work as worker by the Sinhalese, unskilled labor from India was invited and it had many implications in managing labor in Ceylon. Then officially manifested of increasing the working class in Ceylon. According to the authors, managing labor in so-called plantation economy era by itself is the administrating labor legislation. During this period, several legislation were introduced and implemented. As example, Ordinance No. 5 at 1844, Ordinance No. 15, 1858, Service Ordinance Number 11, 1865. Estate Labor Indian Ordinance. Medical Walls Ordinance and etc. Those legislation were not restricted only to plantation workers. During this period, there were substantial development in the areas such as construction, mine, ports, and even domestic service. Legislation introduced by colonial administration were intended to regulate all workers. Ordinance number 11 of 1865 defined service as menial, domestic servant, kankani, working in agriculture, road, railway or other places. However, ordinances introduced by colonial administration were favor of the plantation owners and not sufficient to safeguard the right of the workers. In addition, did not pay appropriate attention to female workers. Then it is clear that early labor legislation did not address the female workers except few rules. As the author, early stage of capitalist mode of production in Ceylon as a whole were unable to identify female labor. They became so-called minority group in organization, separately from male labor. Male labor was the majority group. Soon after the end of the First World War, certain significant changes of legislation had been introduced. The remarkable duration was the period of 1915 to 1925. These changes were nearly affected by the riots which took place in 1915 between Buddhist and a section of Muslims, economic conditions and political-economic demand of the nationalities. During 1915 to 1920, there was a sudden increase of aggressive worries by the Colombo workers and tended to a general strike. The failure of Ceylon Workers League and Ceylon Workers Federation to fill the role of a trade union was evident during the railway and labor strike of 1920. In 1922, a radical labor organization, the Ceylon Labor Union, was formed and used struggle to implement many labor legislation such as Minimum Wage Indian Labor Ordinance, Industrial Dispute Ordinance. However, still female labor in Ceylon remained as silent labor. All organizations and unions were dominated by the men. The remarkable things were that labor legislation in this period basically manifested by men's voice. In 1990, there was a voice of maternity benefit by the Ceylon Workers Welfare League. As a result, two ordinances were introduced. Maternity Benefit Ordinance at 1921, Employment of Women, Young Persons and Children Ordinance at 1928. Employment of females in mines was enacted in 1937. The purpose of this ordinance is utilizing female labor in organization at some extent. During this period, legal legislation were built into the contract of employment for the mutual rights and obligations. Role of female labor in post-independent Sri Lanka. During the movement of being independence, there was not turning point of condition of female labor. Post-independent era recorded female labor force as 570,000 at 1946, 724,000 at 1953. Then annually growth rate was 3.49%. In 1990, it accounts to nearly 2.6 million. The employed female population has increased from 652,000 to nearly 2 million, or by threefold over the period 1963 to 1990. Participation of female in the labor force that accounted for 26% in 1971. It has been increasing and had reached 39% in 1990. There was significant effect of female labor after introducing the liberalized economy at 1977. The proportion of female employee population in primary sector comprising agriculture, forestry, hunting and fishing has declined from 61.9% in 1971 to 43.1% in 1998. As a result, employment in the secondary sector, which includes mining and quarrying, manufacturing and construction, has increased from 12.6% to 24% during the same period. Similarly, in the tertiary sector comprising utilities, commerce, trade, transport, etc., has increased female employment from 19.9% in 1971 to 30% in 1998. Some of the crucial industries in neoliberalized economy space are heavily loaded by female labor. Around 80% of the labor force in the export processing zones were young women. The garment industry has been feminized, with 90% of its employees being young women workers. According to the authors, historical journey through genealogy of managing labor manifests that these changes had not significantly affected the gender stereotyping in so-called modern organization. Therefore, the authors attempted to reread HRM, the symbolic process of managing labor in so-called modern organization, with the postmodern sensibility.